back to the steps of the tower.
It's nice being young.
It used to be. Could we stand and let's worship the Lord this evening? Praise the Lord, God our Redeemer. Oh Lord, you are worthy of all praise. Alleluia. Alleluia. We praise you, Lord. There's none like unto you, oh God, in time or eternity. You are He from everlasting to everlasting, O Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Worship you, my God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, we are still doing things the low-tech way this evening. Everybody can get your own personal audiovisual projection called a songbook. Number 368. All hail the power of Jesus' name. How mighty is our God and worthy of all praise. Praise Him.
And found Him, Lord.
and crown him Lord of all.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And there will be a day when all will acknowledge that he is indeed Lord of lords, King of kings, over all. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Until then, and then after that as well, we'll just keep praising him. I've got a chorus here. I feel like praising him the second time around. I feel like loving him. And then third is serving him. And we can keep doing all of those between here and there. Amen. Until they break forth the diadem to crown him Lord of all, we can go ahead and crown him in our own hearts as Lord of all of our lives. I feel like praising him. And if you don't, do it anyhow. Amen. Because we're not praising for who we are. We're praising for who he is. And he, no matter how we feel, he is always worthy of the praise. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. I'll praise him in the morning and praise him all day long. I feel like praising him. I feel like loving him. I feel like loving him. Love him in the morning, love him all day long. I feel like loving him. I feel like serving him. I feel like serving him. I'll serve him in the morning and serve him all day long. I feel like serving him. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. I'll praise him in the morning and praise him all day long. I feel like praising him, serving. I feel like serving him. I feel like serving him. Serve him in the morning and serve him all day long. I feel like serving him. We'll praise him. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. Praise him in the morning and praise him all day long. I feel like praising him. Loving. I feel like loving him. I feel like loving him. Love him in the morning and love him all day long. I feel like loving him. And I feel like praising him. Oh, I feel like praising him. I'll praise him in the morning and praise him all day long. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. I feel like praising him. Praise him in the morning and praise him all day long. I feel like Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, my Redeemer. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank God, thank God. Do you feel Him tonight? Amen. There may be somebody here that you're going through a problem or something's happened or some situation and you're not feeling what maybe somebody else is feeling. But the beautiful thing is that this is not just based on feelings. Amen. Whether I know He's there, whether I perceive Him or not, God is always with us. In the book of Ezekiel, throughout the scriptures, God has revealed Himself by various titles, various appellations that He has been called. When Abraham offered Isaac, the Lord revealed Himself as Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. In a great battle, He was Jehovah Nissi, their battle standard or their standard. He's presented Himself as Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals thee, or Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who's our healer. And He's presented Himself as Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. But one of the last ones in the Old Testament ways that He revealed Himself was that He was Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is present. He's there. Praise God. He's there. And Jesus is here right now. We can reach out and touch Him. And let's sing that. And while we do it, let's just not let it just be words, but actually from way down deep, take that spiritual hand, reach out, touch Him, take His hand, let Him guide us, let Him help us. Praise God. Jesus is here right now. Praise God. Praise God.
Jesus is here right now, reach out and touch Him. Jesus is here right now to help you receive. Jesus is standing. Jesus is here right now.
reach out and touch him. Jesus is here right now to help you receive. Jesus is standing near, ready your heart to cheer. Jesus is here right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. So many folks don't understand in relation to that song how God works. God's not a vending machine. Where you put in a prayer and pull a lever and get the answer that you want. God always, hear me, God always answers your prayer. Well, I prayed and prayed and prayed and nothing happened. You got an answer to your prayer. It wasn't the one you wanted. But you did get an answer. The answer was no, at least not right now. And sometimes we act like spoiled kids or kids that don't understand or whatever you might say. Can you imagine with me a child running into the house in the summertime at 11:30? Mama's getting out the loaf of bread, the lunch meat, whatever. And he says, Mama, can I have a cookie? And Mama says, no, we're about to have lunch. What she's saying is, I've got something that's better for you than a cookie. And has in mind that a cookie might be later. But then can you see that same child going outside to his friends and saying, I asked Mother for a cookie and I couldn't get an answer. He got an answer. It was no. I'm thankful for some of the times that God has given me no for an answer. He's always heard, and he's always provided. He's always had something good for me. Praise God. Praise God. And one of these days, I'm going to get to see him. Number 2 in your individual projectors, screens, whatever you want to call them. Number 2, oh, I want to see him, to look upon his face. I've got a feeling that when I see him, I'm not going to see that Northern European that is usually pictured as Jesus. Praise God. But I know that having not seen him, we love him. And it will be worth it all to get there to see him. Oh, I want to see him, number 2 in your books. Praise God. As I journey through the land, singing as I go, pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on, through him I must win. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night,
but I cling more close to Him. He will give me life. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside. But my Lord goes ahead and He leads whatever betide. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. Let us sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in valleys low I look, o'er the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, leading in the fight. With a tender hand outstretched o'er the valley low, guiding me I can see as I onward go. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my bark, He doth safely keep. And He leads me in this good. He's a real friend to me. Oh, I love Him so. And oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. Let us sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. There to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, I want to see, look upon His face. There to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, my Savior. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a wonderful, mighty God we serve. Amen. Thank the Lord. We want to go before Him in prayer this evening. Prayer service this evening before church. Multitude of requests were presented. And we prayed for them once. We can pray for them again. We keep sometimes as the importunate woman just kept coming and coming and coming to the unjust judge until finally the unjust judge said, I'm going to offer, or I'm going to answer her petition just to shut her up. That's not the way God works, but it needs to be the way that we work, that we just keep coming and coming and letting our request be made known to the Lord. My doctor has told me that I need to exercise more, and so I've started walking around our development. And after I'd made that trip a few times, I got to thinking, why should I just do this? Let me turn this into something that's profitable another way. Now, bodily exercise does profit a little. That's scriptural. But there can be some things that are even more profitable than that, that can be combined with it. And so I started, as I would make my walk, I'd pray. I made it a prayer walk. I'm making that prayer walk time and again. And a few of the mailboxes have names on them, so I pick up those names and I pray for those people. There's a van that's got a business name on it, so I'm praying for them. After a while, I got tired of saying, Lord, bless these folks that have their sidewalks trimmed so neatly. And in a few houses down, praying, Lord, bless these folks that are about to lose their sidewalk under the grass. And then it finally dawned on me, I don't have to do that. I can go to the library, get a cross-reference, and get the names of everybody that lives in my development. So I did that. Now I've got a spreadsheet that I can carry with me. Lord, bless the Barrett's. God, touch Joe. You see the need here with the Simpsons and this one and that one and so on. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, Brother Moss, you're doing that, what, 5-6 times a week? You know, we've had one of the neighbors come to be at church with us here. Praise the Lord. Well, how long are you going to keep it up? Till I quit walking. And then I've still got the spreadsheet. I don't have to be walking by to pray for them. God, you open up the doors that we can have contact with them. And if I don't have contact with them, you can put somebody else in their path. You can speak to them. You can deal with them. And we just need to pray. God will do the rest of it. We need to pray. We need to ask God to take care of these situations. Some of them we know of. There are things that we don't know. And I wonder this evening if you have a need that you would like to just share with us by an uplifted hand. Lord, I've got a need I'd like to take before you, and I'd like for my brothers and sisters to just take a look around and form what Sister Leela calls that web of agreement. Somebody, I'm going to agree with them. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Jesus, Savior tonight. Across this fellowship, oh God, I pray that your hand would be outstretched to touch and to deliver, to provide and to guide, oh God. Oh Lord, touch those that are ill tonight, oh God. There are those in contact or associated with this church family, oh God, that are battling cancer and other terrible health situations. God, those that are assaulted by our enemy, oh Lord, that old dragon that has opposed your work for all of these millennia, oh God, touch and deliver from the snare of the fowler tonight, I pray. Oh God, for those that are struggling through this world, make provision for them. Oh God, help and deliver those that are in bondage to their own desires and habits, oh God. Oh Lord, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Trust, oh God, that you will deliver and provide. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Well, one of my goals on Sunday night, since there are fewer of us here, I don't always make it, but I try to shake everybody's hand on Sunday night. Praise the Lord. Let's greet each other for a few minutes here. Lord bless you.
All right, I think I've given my father-in-law long enough to shake everybody's hand. So if he didn't shake your hand, it's because he didn't want to. No, I'm teasing. Trying to cause trouble. Last week I picked on my dad, so I figured this week I'd pick on my father-in-law. Nothing like having two dads mad at you. That'll work good, huh? Amen. That's the truth, too. They do get even. Amen. We're glad you're here tonight. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord and beautiful presence of the Lord in this place. It looks like our low-tech worship service is still working. Amen. Which tells you that we really don't need to put as much worry upon all of the things that support us, and we need to focus on us and Jesus. Amen. Amen, amen. Praise God. Praise God. Just a couple of quick announcements. If you were here this morning, you heard them. If you weren't, let me mention them to you. One is our next big event that's coming up that we should be looking at is our Community Friends and Family Day. If you haven't given out some of those cards, there are still some on the kiosk, the invite cards. We'd invite you to do that and pray for the day that God will bring folks that we can minister to, show our hospitality to. And part of that hospitality is that we are the ones who show that hospitality. And so if you are available to help us, the board is filling up with the various tasks and things that we have to do. There's a lot that goes into a Community Friends and Family Day. There's a lot of work, and we always do such a great job with it. But if you haven't signed up in one of those slots and would be willing to, we really need you to. Please, if you would. I kind of asked you last week to make it nice that when Sister Leela gets home, it'll be all filled up and she's good to go. But if you haven't, stop by the board on the way out tonight and put your name down for something. If you've got a question, ask me about it. I can probably explain it to you, whatever the task happens to be. And if we all pull together, each of us taking one thing, then it all comes together pretty smoothly. Amen. So that's our next big thing that's coming up. And I want to pay attention that we will have this coming week, we'll have September-October calendar out. So you can take a look at what's upcoming over the next 2 months. And another week or so. In fact, how many here tonight, school starts this week coming up? How many have got school starting this week? All right, got a few. And if it doesn't start this week, it will start next week. And so getting out of summer and into the fall schedule, which as a pastor I kind of like, because then things kind of go back to normal instead of people going all over the place and traveling and not knowing where they're at and if they're okay and all those kinds of things. Gets a little simpler. Amen, amen. We have ushers tonight. If they would come, receive our offering. I told Jordan I was firing him. It was his fault. Between him and Carrie, they're the newbies, and they broke our computer. I'm going to blame it on them. So I'm firing them from the AV crew. Not really. If Brother Brian can't break it, none of you can. How's that for throwing the elder under the bus there? Amen. Let's stand. Preparation to give. Amen. Am I supposed to tell them what page? No. We're singing a chorus. Oh, don't have to balance your book and your offering. That'll make it easy tonight. Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to give. You've blessed us, and now, Lord, we return to you a portion of that which you've given us. Bless it, direct it, let it be used according to your will, and I pray it in Jesus' name. And everyone say amen.
I will praise the name that is worthy. The name that is worthy. From my sins set me free. He had compassion on me. I will praise that wonderful name. I will praise the name that is worthy. my sin set me free. He had compassion on me. I will praise that wonderful name. I will praise the name that is worthy. I will praise the name that is worthy. From my sin set me free. He had compassion on me. I will praise that wonderful name. I will praise the name that is worthy. I will praise the name that is worthy. From my sin set me free. He had compassion on me. I will praise that wonderful name.
Can we do that right now? Would you lift your voice to him in praise? Jesus, we love you tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I love you, Jesus. I worship you, Lord, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are worthy, Lord, of my love. You're worthy of my worship. You're worthy of my praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I give you that honor. I give you that glory, oh God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God. You may be seated. As we mentioned to you this morning, you're going to have to rely on either listening or your own Bibles. We don't have the projection behind you, so if you do have your Bibles or your tablets or your phone, any of those, turn with me to Luke chapter 6 and verse 27. Luke chapter 6 and verse 27. It's good to have all the babies in the house. You can hear them. And I'm glad they're here. If they irritate you, move. Babies are important. As babies grow up to be children, children grow up to be teenagers. We'd love to skip that stage, but anyway, we have to go through that in order to get to young adults. And young adults become meaningfully employed and contributing members of society. And then, if you don't watch it too long, they become parents, and then, before you know it, they have become parents of young adults. It's hard for me to believe that my little boy, Monday, tomorrow, turns 17. Can you believe that? I am the father of a 17-year-old. That is crazy. Isn't it, Sister Betty? That is just crazy. I'm not having any trouble with my age, but I don't know. Trust me, I'm glad they're growing up. That's not the problem I'm having. It just, the two put together just doesn't quite work. Sister Bev, I can't be the father of a 17-year-old. That just doesn't make any sense. And yet, it's the reality. Believe it or not, my son will have a single vote, but a vote nonetheless, in who the next president of the United States is. Lord save us. Anyway, it seems like just yesterday that I was holding him in the crook of my knee and feeding him the leftovers of my crunch bars as he would suck that little bit of ice cream off the end of that stick before I would throw it away. And he liked it then, and Regina, that's why he likes ice cream now. His mother put constraints on how much they could have. She says, you can have two scoops. Y'all figured out what they did? They're now working on what the size of a scoop is. Let me just say that they've gotten really good at very carefully creating a massive scoop. Two scoops. When you make a law, then you get to use that law to your benefit. But Mom, you said two scoops. These are two scoops. Two reasonable scoops. Well, this is what Dad eats, and then we're off to the races. So there we go. Anyway, happy birthday, Vincent. It's hard to believe that you are 17, or almost. You should be 17. You brat, you stayed in your mother's womb a whole week longer than you should have. Anyway, those of you that were around may remember that story. He got in there and stuck his butt down instead of his head down. And anyway, Luke chapter 6 and verse 27, Jesus is speaking. He says, but to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other cheek also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks. And when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Now I want you to pause right there. 27 through 30. How many of you are excited to obey Jesus? Is that your normal impulse? You love your enemies? You find out somebody didn't like you, so you try to find how to be good to them. Unless you're defining good as in revenge. I don't think most of us humans go out of our way to be good to those who hate us. I don't think when someone curses you, we say, bless you. I think the impulse is to give it back to them. When somebody hurts me, oh, I pray for them, but I don't think it's the way Jesus was talking about praying for them. I promise you, you slap me in the cheek, I'm not inclined to turn around and say, you want another shot? You steal my coat, I let you have it, and I offer you my shirt also. When someone, and you can't clean up verse 30, okay? Give to anyone who asks. No, this is Jesus saying it in the vein of all these people that are abusing you and misusing you and not treating you right. When they ask you for something, you give it to them. So this isn't, you know, my good friend asks me for something and I give it to him. No, this is my enemy. This is somebody that hates me, somebody that abuses me, somebody that doesn't like me. When things are taken away, don't try to get them back. Just let them go. That's the context for verse 31. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. Then he embellishes. Verse 32, he says, if you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners, even wicked people, even ungodly people love those who love them. You can be a down and dirty scoundrel. And if somebody scratches your back, you have a tendency to scratch their back back. Jesus says, you don't get any credit for loving those who love you. Even sinners do that. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. If you can show the bank that they'll get their money back, they'll lend you money. Gladly. Doesn't make the bank a saint. makes it a business. Then Jesus moves and he says, love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Who's the them? Your enemies. Then your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High. For he is kind, the Most High is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate just as your Father is compassionate. Jesus, in verse 31, do to others as you would like them to do to you, is tapping into something that has already been stated in the Old Testament in Leviticus chapter 19, verses 17 and 18. Speaking through Moses, he says, do not nurse hatred in your heart for any of your relatives. Confront people directly, so you will not be held guilty for their sin. Boy, I could spend some time on that. Confront people directly. Do you know we live in a society that the vast majority of us are conflict averse? We have a major, major issue. We are scared to death of conflict. Therefore, we are the most grumpy, nasty, antagonistic society that exists. Because we're all walking around carrying the junk of a thousand little cuts. Because we won't go to the person that the fault's with. We bury it. Yahweh speaking through Moses says, do not nurse hatred in your heart for any of your relatives. Confront people directly so you will not be held guilty for their sin. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against a fellow Israelite, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. This is what Jesus is tapping into in Luke chapter 6 when he says, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. This command was very popular in Jesus' day. In fact, history tells us that Hillel the Elder, one of the rabbis of Jesus' time, he was born about 110 before the Common Era and died about 10 of the Common Era. So he died during the time that Jesus was a young lad. He used this verse, this Leviticus 19 verse 18, as a message for Torah, for the law, for his teachings. One time a Gentile challenged him and says, look, you guys got too many laws. I can't follow everything. He says, I will be converted under one condition. If you can explain to me all of Torah during the time that I'm able to stand on one foot. Which, unless you're in really, really good shape, isn't very long. Because you're out of balance, it requires strength. So, you know, you don't have very long, you can make it. See, I'm embarrassing myself. I can't make it very long. So it's a rather short period of time. So he challenges this Jewish rabbi. He says, sum up all of Torah. So Hillel accepted him as a candidate for conversion. But the reason that he was able to accept him is because he drew upon Leviticus 19, verse 18, and said to the man, what is hateful to you, don't do to your fellow. That's the whole of Torah. The rest is explanation. All of the law of Moses can be summed up in don't do to others what is hateful to you. Everything else is explanation. So Jesus is tapping and is explaining, and Hillel seems to have been lined up pretty well, because Jesus wasn't just a rabbi. Jesus was God himself. Jesus was the revealer of Torah. Jesus was the one who revealed the law. It was the one that Moses was speaking under his authority when he said, love your neighbor. So when Jesus in verse 31 is recorded here as saying, do to others as you would like them to do to you, we have to understand that this isn't Some Christians try to pull a fast one on this one. They go, well, that's how I'm supposed to treat my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I don't think you read the context if you draw that conclusion. Because most of the time, your brothers and sisters in Christ are not your enemies. Most of the time, they're not abusing you. Most of the time, they're not stealing your coat. Most of the time, I can't remember the last time I saw a brother or sister slap one another in the face. I really don't think I've seen it recently. I really don't. I mean, I haven't seen it. I don't see that kind of a thing. And so, clearly, Jesus is the context of this, do to others as you would like them to do to you, is not just about your brothers and sisters in Christ. It's, as he says, it's not just about those who treat you right. Because to what gain is that? To what credit is that? Even the world, even sinners, even ungodly people do right, take care of, treat fairly those who treat them fairly. No, the real test is, what do I do when Liz curses me out? That's the real test. It's not when Liz treats me right. It's when Liz curses me out. See, the real test is not when my wife is sweet and nice, the reason I married her. It's when she's the pill. Oh, I know, you can't ever imagine Regina being a pill, but she is. See, the test, and Jesus is very careful to set this up. He brackets this verse 31. It's known as the golden rule, by the way. He brackets it by talking about the bad circumstances. He talks about people hating you. He talks about people abusing you. He talks about your enemies on both sides of this. And in the middle of it says, do to others as you would like them to do to you. Tonight I want to spend a little bit of time talking about conduct of a Christian. Conduct of a Christian. And I want to apply this pretty specifically. If you want to take your place within the body of Christ, and if you want to do what God has called you to do within the body of Christ, you have got to internalize verse 31. You have to. Because your brothers and your sisters are broken human beings just like you. They get mad just like you. They open their mouths and say things they shouldn't say just like you. They have reason to repent just like you. And the conduct of a Christian is, if we can't learn how to treat one another according to verse 31, how are we ever going to treat the lost, the sinner, the wicked, the unrighteous, according to verse 31? Jesus, at the end of this passage that I've read to you, makes a statement. You must be compassionate just as your Father is compassionate. I don't know if you've ever noticed, but when I'm mad, I don't know if this happens to you, but when I'm mad, I don't have much compassion. I don't see things from other people's perspective. I see them from my perspective. Am I just talking to myself, or does anybody here understand what I'm talking about? They are so flat wrong, ignorant, arrogant, and everything else. I don't have any compassion for them. I don't think about where they're coming from. I expect them to do better. I'm not talking about your normal personality. I'm talking about when you finally had enough, when somebody finally got your goat. I don't know what that phrase means. I don't have a goat to get. But I think we all kind of understand what we're talking about. When they finally have gotten a hold of you, they have crossed a line with you, they have ticked you off, you finally had enough. You don't see things from the other person's perspective. You see it from your perspective. That's how I see it. Can I get an amen? Boy, that was really feeble. Really? Y'all can't be honest in that. Now, come on, really? Can I get a better amen? Okay. We and some of you don't get mad as much as I do. I understand that. God bless all you weak people. That wasn't without a plan. I was just testing it out a little bit. Let's see how much you're still listening. It's not a matter how much you get mad. It's not a matter of how much you get hurt. It's not a matter of how pleasant you are, or how barbary you are, or how, you know, prickly you are. It's not a matter of that. It's a matter of when you get mad. Jesus said, you're supposed to be compassionate just as your Father's compassionate. Do you think God likes your sin? Do you think God enjoys my sin? I'm telling you right now, God's not happy when we sin. And yet Scripture tells us that He is our Father who has compassion upon us. In the midst of us being wrong. Not a misunderstanding. See, a lot of times we Christians, we go, well, that was a misunderstanding. No. Let's take away a misunderstanding. Let's just say the other person is flat wrong. It's not miscommunication. It's not misunderstanding. It's flat wrong. Unequivocally, without a question, wrong. It'd stand up in Jesus' court of law. What does Jesus call a Christian to do in their conduct? He calls you to be compassionate. How many of you automatically do that? Good. I'm glad. No, you don't, Marcus. You are one of the most intolerant little boys I've ever met. Yeah, call him cute sometimes, see what happens. Or just watch him and Brother Keith get into it. He's just incensed. Brother Keith's trying to say he's on the schedule to play the percussion, and Marcus just won't have anything to do with it. No, I'm not talking about how we conduct ourselves when we realize, oh, you know, I wasn't real clear in what I said. Oh, I misunderstood what you said. Nah, forget those. Those are easy. No, the ones where the other person is flat wrong. They have abused you. They have misused you. They have hated on you. They are your enemy. Jesus calls a Christ follower. That's what a Christian is. One who follows the teachings of Christ. He calls that person to have compassion and to switch roles. To put yourself in the place of the other person and say, now what would I want if I were the enemy? I were just flat wrong. I had hurt me. What would I want done to me? This is a really hard principle to live out. I think it is interesting to me that Jesus, when he was asked about the law, He gave two commandments. He says, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is like to the first. Love your neighbor as yourself. That's that same passage that Hillel is tapping into and that Jesus is tapping into here to make this statement, the golden rule. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. Do you know who I have the worst trouble doing this with? My dad. Because I expect better of him. Think about it. I'm serious. I'm here to help somebody. Because this is part of our problem in the church. We excuse ourselves of our Christian conduct when we think the other person should know better. Well, my dad should always know better. There is never a time that Pop should be wrong. So that's where I have the most trouble, because I grew up, I mean, Rick, you grew up with me. This guy, he knew everything. Now, having grown up to adulthood, we realized that was a fallacy. He didn't know everything, but he did know a whole lot. But even knowing a whole lot, he didn't know as much as, I mean, it's tough getting to be an adult and realizing that things are more complicated in life. So I get aggravated with my father. I do. By the way, he gets aggravated with me too. It's fun. Us navigating this thing has been a lot of fun. Really has. Can you imagine having your son, the one that you held in your arms, turn into the one who's carrying out what you gave your life for? If you think that's warm and fuzzy, yeah, not so much. And then when you've built your son to stand up to you, to question you, to challenge you, and in that moment, that's the moment he shouldn't be questioning. He should be saying yes, sir, and saluting. But he took seriously how you trained him. And so now he's pushing on you, and now he's questioning you. No, it's a lot of fun. Between Dad and I, it's a lot of fun. Back and forth. My mother just shakes her head and says, Jesus, take me home. Am I right? Do I speak the truth? Yeah, she tells us to leave the house. If we're in the house, she's like, go away. Go to the church. Go to Steve's house. No, the one I have the most trouble, I don't have as much trouble with the church. I don't. All of you I don't have as much trouble with, because I view my responsibility. Now, I'm only using this by way of example. I don't have as much trouble because I know as pastor what the job was. That's why I didn't want to be a preacher. I didn't want to make myself submitted to you. My goodness. You people are fickle at times. You do dumb things at times. You make poor choices at times. And then I got to walk with you through the mess. Oh, I didn't want to sign up for this. You're dumb and I got to pay for it. Not interested, Jesus, no. So once I resolved that in my heart and my mind and realized that's what the calling is, that's what being a pastor is, I don't have as much trouble with that. But I do have trouble looking over at Pop and Mom, and if they're not quite the way they should be, or they get mad at me, and then they, because they're not always compassionate about me either. We raised you better than that, boy. Now, I'm only using this example of me and Dad. Simply, you need to fill in your own examples. Jesus did not give us any excuses for not obeying this command. There are no exception clauses. He calls us to do to others as you would like them to do to you. I don't want to think about when I'm old. I don't want to think about when I'm, 76 years old. How do I want somebody to treat me when I'm absolutely positive they're wrong? Now, you take your own example. You take whoever it is that you're in conflict with, whoever has mistreated you, whoever is, then in that moment, they're struggling in how they're conducting themselves. Jesus says you need to have compassion And I believe this. If you want to understand verse 31, I believe it's rooted in compassion. It's empathy. It's the ability to get out of yourself and put yourself in the other person's position. And in that other place, do to them as you would like them to do to you if your roles were reversed. I spend hours every week, hours pounding, either by explicit quotation or by direction, pounding this at my children. They are abysmal. They stink so bad at this. They get into so much trouble because they won't follow verse 31. If they just followed verse 31, everything would be okay. All the fights that they have would be gone. All the problems they have would be gone. But they can't do it because they're sure they're right. And it doesn't matter what the other person's feeling. The world's all about me. That's my children. The world is all about me. I hope nobody gets mad at me tonight, but how much as a Christian do you go about thinking the world is all about me? Jesus put as a prerequisite for discipleship, he says, to be my disciple, you must deny self. Guess what, folks? That means when you decide to be a disciple of Christ, when I said I will follow Jesus, that means that by definition, life is not about me. Because to be his disciple, I have to deny self. Not deny self vis-a-vis him. Oh, we gussy that up real good. Well, yeah, for Jesus. I'll put Jesus, but I ain't putting you ahead of me. Yet we're missing the point that how we love our God is demonstrated in how we love our neighbor. Jesus calls us into accountability about our love for him, not by what we do for him, but by how we love him through loving our neighbor. I'm convinced that Jesus is watching us on verse 31. And he's having compassion on us. Thank God for that. Amen. He's having compassion because, boy, we're having trouble. I picked on Dad enough. Brian and Lynn have been so good. They've moved up to the second pew. Isn't that great? They're doing good. Brian's starting to scoot in, so there's a few seats left on the aisle there. Look at that. Did Lynn do that? Did she move it in? Oh, she doesn't want to move in. Oh, you threw her under the bus. Thump, thump. Oh, perfect. It's going to play right in, going to play right into where I'm going. Tonight, when Brian and Lynn go home. Lynn is not interested in what Brian was feeling when I just out of the blue put him on the spot and blew him up there. No, she going to give him a chewing for having thrown her under the bus. How dare you, Brian? Bet Brother Keith could mimic this a whole lot better. Brother Keith spends a lot of time with Brother Brian and Sister Lynn. He could probably mimic how it goes. She's not empathizing with Brother Brian, the pressure he was feeling, the fact the preacher sideswiped him there and all that. You were a jerk, Brian. It's hard to do what Jesus has called us to, and yet a Christian conduct requires it. Liz brought a boyfriend tonight. I found out he's a Marine. You've been through boot camp, I assume, right? Did you enjoy everything they put you through in boot camp? Did you? That was a no, sir, in case you didn't hear it. Did you know how to do everything they told you to do when you went into boot camp? Not a thing. Did that sergeant say, oh, I'm really sorry that you're having trouble with that. You don't have to do that. I didn't think so. I had a sneaky suspicion that wasn't his response. He don't give a rat's patootie whether you know how to do it. I'm going to show you, son, and then you go do it. Well, it's hard. I don't care if it's hard. Do it. If a military of a human country can demand out of its soldiers, I promise you, our master, who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who lives inside of us and says, I, by my spirit, give you the power to be my follower. He's not going to let Sister Lynn off the hook. Any more than he lets Brother Brian off the hook when he gets aggravated with Sister Lynn. Now that's a marriage relationship, so broaden it out. Marky's not off the hook when Brother Keith's bugging the dickens out of him. I'm not off the hook when my father's bugging the dickens out of me. Now, the only reason I'm not going to other examples is because I might step on a real one. So I don't want to step on a real one, okay? So everybody understand, that's the only reason I'm not calling out other names again. But you can fill it in. Some of you might even know the real one. So fill in the blank. Jesus has called us to do to others as you would have them do to you. This is the conduct of a Christian. If you want to take your place within the body, you have to understand there's no getting out of this. Now, I have a tendency in sermons to overmake my point, so humor me. Let me overmake my point. In Matthew chapter 18, Jesus seems to deal with this. He says in verse 15, he says, if another believer sins against you, go privately and point out the offense. If the other person listens and confesses it, you have won that person back. But if you are unsuccessful, take one or two others with you and go back again so that everything you say may be confirmed by two or three witnesses. If the person still refuses to listen, take your case to the church. Then if he or she won't accept the church's decision, treat that person as a pagan or a corrupt tax collector. Now, I know that most of you think, yeah, I hope they don't receive the church's direction. How have we already been instructed on how to treat a pagan or a tax collector? Love them. Bless them. Pray for them. I treat them nasty. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth, verse 18, will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. I also tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. For where two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them. Now, in case you think the topic has moved on, verse 21, Peter comes to him and says, Lord, how often should I forgive someone who sins against me? Seven times. Peter thinks he's doing well. Peter thinks he's presenting himself well. I'm going to forgive him seven times. Jesus replies, no, not seven times, but 70 times seven. For those of you that are mathematically challenged, I believe that's 490. There could be the contention made, too, that it's about that single sin. So in other words, you don't get to say, Brother Brian, you got 490 shots, and then Lynn's done with you. Aren't you glad? Because I bet you've already run through all 488 of them. You only got two, buddy. Brother Brian may have to love his enemy by the time the night's over. Free marriage counseling from one of the elder couples will be available to you following service. Now, listen to what Jesus does. Verse 23, he says, therefore. So on the basis of this statement about forgiveness, on the basis of Peter's question about forgiveness, based upon his response to Peter that it's much more than what Peter has said, Therefore, the kingdom of heaven can be compared to a king who decided to bring his accounts up to date with servants who had borrowed money from him. In the process, one of his debtors was brought in who owed him millions of dollars. Yes, millions with an M. Millions of dollars. I love little notes. It's the equivalent of 375 tons or 340 metric tons of silver. It was a lot of money. He couldn't pay. So his master ordered that he be sold, along with his wife, his children, and everything he owned to pay the debt. Everything was legit. The master had a right to do this. Now pay attention. Pay attention. But the man fell down before his master and begged him, "Please be patient with me and I will pay it all." Then his master was filled with pity for him. He had compassion on him. And he released him and forgave his debt. Does everybody see that? The man owes the debt. It's not that something went shady. It's not that, none of that. He legitimately owed his master millions. The master had a legitimate right. Had him dead to rights. But he had compassion. The master here, the kingdom of heaven is comparable to. The master had compassion. Just as Jesus said in the other passage, as your Father has compassion on you, so you should have compassion on one another. So he releases him, he forgives his debt. But when the man left the king, he went to a fellow servant who owed him a few $1,000s. So this first one was servant to God. It was the vertical relationship. Now we get the horizontal relationship. Servant to servant, neighbor to neighbor, Christian to Christian, human to human. He goes to his fellow servant who owes him a few $1,000s. He grabs him by the throat and demands instant payment. His fellow servant fell down before him and begged him for a little more time. "Be patient with me and I will pay it," he pleaded. But his creditor wouldn't wait. He didn't follow Jesus' command. He didn't do to others as he would have done to him. And in this case, he wouldn't do to others as was done to him. He had the man arrested, put in prison, till the debt could be paid in full. When some of the other servants saw this, they were very upset, and they went to the king and told him everything that had happened. Then the king called in the man he had forgiven and said, "You evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you do to him as was done to you? Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you?" Then the angry king sent the man to prison to be tortured until he paid his entire debt. "That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters from your heart." Sheesh. This is some hardcore. This is like, don't play around here. The only way you lose the compassion of God is to refuse to do to your fellow human being what he has done to you. So I don't care how frustrated I am with my dad. I don't care how smart he is. How he should know better. In whatever it happens to be. What do I want when I'm 76 years old? man, I've only been serving Jesus 15 years, and that sister's been serving God 30 years. She should know better. It's not going to cut it, ladies and gentlemen. It's not going to cut it. It will stop you from being able to take your place within the body. This will stop you. I didn't say that you were going to be perfect in it. In fact, I'm going to tell you right now, you won't be. You'll struggle with it. That's why I've been transparent. That's why I put Dad and I on blast. I didn't say it, but I'll tell you flat out right now. He has trouble at times, too, because he gets really aggravated with me, too. I raised you, boy. You know better. How dare, and there it goes. You go ask my mama if he doesn't. I'm not even in the house, and I know I trigger it. Jesus calls us to act this way towards all humans. When he puts, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, in the context of your enemies, those who hate you, those who abuse you, those who misuse you. Which means that in the house of God, there's no way we're going to get away with this. Now, why am I preaching this to you? Why am I bringing this to you? Why am I exhorting you in this? Nobody needs to go around worrying that our Father's lost his compassion. But if you ever shut down and say, I refuse to forgive that person, I'm not ever going to do what Jesus said and do unto them as I would have them do unto me if I were in their place. That is the moment where you will shut down God's forgiveness. And this message tonight is to call a church to remember the conduct of a Christian, because we cannot ever shut down on this principle. No matter how hard it is, no matter how uncomfortable it is. He demands it of us. So the next time you're in conflict, by the way, you notice the passages I read to you, there's the word confrontation in there. Isn't that amazing? You're actually supposed to go confront a brother or sister. If you've ever been in my house, I'm not having to repeat that to my children. They know about confrontation. They're not having any trouble confronting one another. They've got no problem letting their sibling know what they did wrong to them. They make it clear and loud. Know what they struggle with and what we struggle with. Is that once you've expressed yourself, there's an extra step. Put yourself in the other person's place. And before you do anything, ask yourself, what would I want if I were them? Everything you've done, everything of how you live, how you've treated your brother or sister, if you put it through this principle, you'll then realize how you could be right and still wrong. You could be right about whatever it is they're wrong about, and yet how you responded to it was wrong. And that wrong is bigger than their wrong. This is how Christians find themselves in a place of humility instead of pride. This is how you've got to understand something. I can never present to you a pastor. I can never present the pastor as someone who is not broken and needs your mercy as much as you need mine. I don't have it together. None of us do. reason I can give you mercy is because I need mercy. The reason I can be compassionate is because I need compassion. It doesn't change anything. It doesn't make it more fun. It doesn't mean that hurts don't happen. But they become less important. They're not what's operative. They're not how the decision is made. The decision is made according to Jesus' call to this principle: do to others as you would have them do to you. I'm going to make a bold statement. You want to succeed as a Christian? Obey this command. And if you simply come back to this command over and over and over again, all the other commands to lift from Hillel are simply explanations. Do to others as you would have them do to you. Regina, if you come. This church will operate that way. We will operate that way. We'll be patient with you as you struggle to be obedient to that. But if you want to harbor feelings in your heart, if you want to hold on to spirits and attitudes that are contrary to that principle, you're going to be in conflict. And purposefully, let me tell you who you'll be in conflict with. Me. I'll come after you. Not to throw you away, but to hopefully reconcile you. But reconciliation will come by you abiding by that principle. If you want to take your place in a body, if you feel there's a call on your life, which every Christian, I believe, there is a call on your life, you must live according to this principle. There is no place for hatred for your brother. There's no place for dislike of your brother. And if you have it, you need to do to others as you would have them do to you. It's interesting, the context that I read to you of the illustration of this principle, which I believe that parable about the king and the two servants is a perfect illustration of it. It's almost word to word. It matches up. Right before that is the context of how you make things right, of how you conduct yourself. You don't talk about your brother or sister. You go to them. You don't talk to one another. You go to them. Let me suggest to you very strongly that if after having gone to them, they've not received you or there's not been able to be successful resolution, come and get me and my wife. We're committed to you and to them. Let us be in that meeting where again you reach for your brother or your sister. At the end of the day, even if they reject you, even if they refuse you, and by the way, that behavior will be rejected and refused by us, you still are called to love them. You are still called to pray for them. You are still called to bless them. You are still called to do good to them. You don't harbor anything. You literally, you let it go. Now it's in the hands of your master. Now you're no longer responsible. And you don't hold it against them. You love them as if nothing happened. You say, preacher, you don't understand where I'm coming from. You don't understand the issues I've dealt with. No, I don't understand that. But I'm telling you, search the scriptures. There's no caveat. There is no parenthetical phrase. There is no exception clause. Jesus demands this. And remember, this isn't my kingdom. This isn't my church. I didn't die for this church. Jesus died for this church. It's his kingdom. And when you're a king, you get to set the laws. He set this as a law. Because if you won't forgive your brother, I won't forgive you. That's what he said. I didn't say it. He said it. You have aught against your brother or sister, you need to make it right. I'm going to tell you a little trick about something. Okay? I'm going to close with this. Really easy. You know, Brother Keith, I don't like going to people and telling them I'm mad at them. I don't like doing that. Now, occasionally I have to. But I don't like doing that. I don't like going and saying, Brother Keith, I had aught against you. I thought bad things about you. So you know what I do? I just don't start down that path. Because I don't feel like coming and telling you later I'm mad at you. So if you're dumb, I just immediately, I let you off the hook. I don't harbor anything. Because then nothing started. I don't have any awe. Now, I'll be honest with you. With my dad, I harbor stuff. I get mad at him. He knows better. So I have to go to him. I have to make it right. My wife, she definitely knows better. I have to go to her all the time and say, I'm sorry. All you folks, if you're looking for me to be coming to you, I'm telling you, it's going to be a rare thing that I'm coming to you saying, would you forgive me? Because the reason is because I don't get mad at you. I just don't go there. I'm not saying you don't ever give me reason to be mad, but I just, do you know how many of you there are? Do you know how often I'd be having to have meetings? So you want to simplify your life? Don't even let the seed take hold. By the way, I'm not some brilliant guy. I just got taught that by my parents. I watched them take all kinds of things and just not even start with it. Don't even harbor it. That's why we'd get home and it was as if nothing had happened. We was at church and somebody just cussed them out. It's as if nothing happened. They just let it go. See, how'd they do that? I think they just got tired of a complicated life and said, man, it's much simpler to just obey right away. Let's not hold on to it. Let's not harbor it. Let's not. And I've had people, they get really aggravated with me. They're like, are you mad at me? I'm like, no, I'm not mad at you. They don't believe me. I'm like, you got to be mad at me. I'm like, no, I'm not mad at you. I don't have time. There's too many of you, and you're all doing stuff that would make me mad in normal circumstances. I don't have the time. I don't hold on to it. I let it go. I let it go. I let it go. I don't hold on to it. I don't think about it. I don't store it in my brain. Now, I haven't learned how to do that with my dad. I store stuff on him. I get mad at him. I haven't done that on my wife yet. Mm-mm. They know better. I got to work on it. I do. I'm being honest with you. I do. I got to work on it because I get mad at them. You should be able to count on them. Can't believe that they're being that dumb. So don't tell me I don't empathize. I know where you are. I understand. You're doing a work for God. You're doing something and your brother or sister's getting in the way. And you're like, man, you should be helping me instead of getting in the way. I'm telling you, it'll get a whole lot simpler if you just don't go there. And you can. It's not a gimmick. Now, you got to be honest with yourself about it, but I'm serious. It's not a gimmick. You can literally let it go. None of you get to offend me. I won't let you. No matter what you do, I'm loving you. You're stuck with me. And I'm praying the Father's going to have compassion on me while I work on my wife and my dad. My in-laws don't even tick me off. Well, that plow in the garage is probably ticking me off a little bit, but a horse-drawn plow. Good Lord. My father-in-law has a horse-drawn plow, not mechanized, horse-drawn, that he called all the way from Oklahoma. For what? I have no idea. Oh, you hauled it from Tennessee to Oklahoma, then from Oklahoma to here. That makes it even more dumb, Dad. All right, maybe I got my father, my father-in-law, and my wife. I got to work on those three. This altar's open. I've given a little levity, but we got to live up to this. We got to live up to it. It's the conduct of a Christian. And there's no excuse. Your master will have enough mercy to help you get there. But you got to commit to this. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Whiter than snow. Wash me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow.
I spent a portion of my life winning and not really feeling good about it. You can win, you can have your way, and then not feel very good about it. Because that's not the Christian way. And you can appear to lose when you follow this principle. It appears you lost. You can feel real good about it. It sounds like double talk. You're not a loser. Because the value of a person is higher than being right. And none of us see perfect. Does not mean one doesn't have boundaries. Nobody deserves to be abused. And you need to draw a line. Yeah, we're not talking about that. Amen. Let's stand and thank the Lord. Where you have the most difficulties when you expect more out of a person than what they're doing or what they're giving. And at least that's where I have the difficulty. Because they should know better. Well, anyway, so then you figure out whether you want to have mercy when you should know better. Or you just want you want the opposite side of that. And it really works. It really works. And we're all sensitive people. And we've all had things happen to us that make us super sensitive in certain areas. And that's where the challenge comes. And, if you just go and... I've always... If someone has aught with me, I'm sorry, even if I'm right or wrong. I can always say, I'm sorry you have, you know, have aught with me. Now I realize you looking at my wife, she does everything perfect. Eleanor, where are you? Not down here yet. You know, she is absolutely St. Eleanor. I don't have that problem. And wherever you are, the Lord loves us. This really is a principle. And be able to back off and say, how important is it? Even if someone is, you know, they're absolutely dead wrong. They're absolutely wrong. How important it is related to the relationship. You don't have to admit you're wrong. You have to admit you're sorry that there's conflict. Amen. Hallelujah. And when we all get to heaven, we're going to be like Jesus. And if you don't like me there, then you got a really big problem. Yeah. This operation, you cannot have the diversity of backgrounds that we have, even in just a portion of our congregation here tonight, and not have cultural conflict. I mean, that's why folks say when they look at it from a human standpoint, this is impossible, because you're not going to be able to get along. Well, they don't know the power of Christ. You see, it's the power of Christ being willing to be right and still give another person the opportunity to be wrong and still your brother. And then maybe you find out at times they're giving you the opportunity to be wrong. I mean, it's a mutual kind of thing. Amen. Well, they should know better. Well, so should we at times. Amen. Stephen and I communicate loudly. If you've ever heard us communicate loudly, we're not mad at each other. We're just absolutely convinced that the other person doesn't know what they're doing. And you know what happens in those, and you don't have to deal with it that way. But, you know, I've really learned a lot growing up with him. And I really learned a lot growing up with my wife. And then throw all of you in. Oh, my goodness. We really had opportunity to grow up in Christ Jesus and stay in fellowship with one another. Amen. So it isn't something, Jesus isn't asking to do something that's impossible. Amen. And the key to the thing is, take the risk to go to the person. The risk is, you feel you might be rejected, because we all have been. Go to them anyway. And then if it can't be resolved, get somebody that's, and then go again to try to resolve, so there's no odd. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. God, we thank you for this foundational Christian principle that you settled, Lord Jesus. Yes, when you were here in this earth, Lord Jesus, and how you were treated. Yes, Lord Jesus. And yet, instead of holding on, you went to Calvary for every single one of us. And God, we thank you, Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit and being aware of it, Lord Jesus. God, and then by making a mistake and asking forgiveness, that we can grow in you, Lord Jesus. Till that day that we're just exactly like you, we're going to be in your image and yet be unique one for another. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your presence here. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your wonderful name. God bless you. We're glad to have you. And have a good evening.